Good evening. I'm Dr. Robert Peppercorn, and this is the Medical Explorer. As a specialist in skin diseases and allergies, and as host of this program, I will take you on an exploration of the medical communities of our Northern California counties and bring you behind the scenes of medical care practices right here in our local areas. Tonight, the Medical Explorer will take you behind the closed doors of the chest surgery operating rooms of St. Joseph Medical Center in Stockton, as we meet again with one of Northern California's most respected surgeons, Dr. Alan Coulson. This evening, Dr. Coulson will show us a technique that allows surgeons to look into the chest and perform biopsies and other procedures without the need for major surgery. Tonight, Dr. Coulson will show us an actual thoracoscopy as he uses high-tech video, fiber optics, and lasers to show us the inside of the chest of several of his patients as he removes a piece of lung and some other tissue to look for cancer and other diseases. This is the first time that this procedure has been shown on local television, and the view is fascinating. In the pharmacy corner tonight, our award-winning neighborhood pharmacist will tell us about the role of calcium supplements in the body. Do we need to take extra calcium to keep our bodies healthy? Well, we'll learn the answer to this question and others about calcium and its safety in the pharmacy corner tonight. Tonight's program will be extremely timely and informative, and I hope that you'll stay with us for the next half hour. Before getting to our topics tonight, let's take a look at the latest medical news. More bad news for smokers, and this time you can see it with your naked eyes. A new study from the University of Utah has confirmed that cigarette smoking causes premature facial wrinkling. The scientists studied over 100 Caucasian women of European backgrounds. Facial wrinkling worsened with increasing sun exposure, but also with years of smoking independent of sun exposure, sex, or age. Lifetime sun exposure exceeding 50,000 hours increased the risk of being wrinkled threefold, while smokers of more than 10 years were 5 times more likely to be wrinkled than non-smokers. Sun exposure and smoking acted independently. Individuals who smoked heavily and spent many years in the sun were 12 times more likely to be wrinkled than those that didn't have these risk factors. The conclusion? Not only does smoking cause death, it will also make you look older. How about that for another reason to kick the habit? It's now time for us to visit our pharmacy corner as we learn the latest up-to-date information on the world of drugs and medications from one of our area's most respected neighborhood pharmacists. Returning tonight in our pharmacy corner is our award-winning registered pharmacist, Bob Church, from the Medicine Shop Pharmacy in Marysville. Bob, welcome back to the Medical Explorer.
Thank you. It's nice to be here.
Always a pleasure. It seems that doctors and pharmacists are faced with the daily question about taking vitamins and mineral supplements and calcium, and that's everybody's concern. What's the role of calcium in our body?
Well, there's several roles of calcium in our body. Primarily, 99% of our calcium is stored in our bones, which adds support and strength to our skeleton. However, there are other very important uses for calcium, such as nerve transmission, muscle contraction, regulation of enzyme processes in our body, blood clotting. There's a lot of very important things that go on every day with, and calcium is very important to do that.
I remember in medical school studying drugs which were very new at that time called calcium channel blocking drugs that affected blood pressure and the heart.
That's correct.
So the idea even back then of calcium was becoming important.
Absolutely.
Why do you think there's sort of an increasing interest in calcium?
I think the increase in the last couple of years we've seen is because of all of the media attention to the osteoporosis issue. Osteoporosis being a condition where you're losing gradually the bone mass that you originally started with, and primarily in older adults you see a lot of that. It's interesting though that the facts now sort of support the fact that when you take calcium supplements, you may slow this demineralization or bone loss down. However, you are not going to stop it, and you certainly are not going to add to the bone mass.
I guess a lot of people talk about vitamin D with calcium, too, to make it absorb more, and I know there have been medications around with combinations of those for quite a long time.
Definitely, and I'm not sure that those combinations in those strengths are really doing much for the absorption of the calcium.
Well, tell us about some of the different calcium supplements.
Okay, there are several calcium supplements, and basically they differ in the fact that some of them give you more elemental calcium, which is really what you're looking for. Calcium carbonate seems to be the one that gives you more calcium per tablet, smaller tablet size, better absorption than the rest of them. However, there's been a controversy lately about the absorbency or the dissolution of the tablets. And there's an interesting little test that people can do at home with their calcium carbonate tablets. Mm. Put a tablet in about 6 ounces of white vinegar at room temperature. Stir it occasionally. If your tablet dissolves within a half an hour, you have a fairly high-grade tablet.
Oh, and that's interesting.
Yeah, it's just a little thing you can do at home to kind of assure yourself that your calcium is... calcium citrate, which is a product that we don't see used a lot, but for somebody whose physician has told them that they don't have a lot of basic stomach acid, hydrochloric acid in their stomach, if they use calcium citrate, the absorption will be much better than if they use some of the other ones.
Are there any dangerous or side effect type problems from taking calcium?
Well, really, those are very, very minimal. Maybe some minor nausea, constipation, a little gas, but other than that, really not. I think, though, people who have a history of kidney stones definitely need to speak with their physician before they start taking calcium.
Right, they'd want to know how much calcium would be in those things, in their kidney stones. If they've ever had kidney stones analyzed, if they form those kidney stones with calcium, time to watch out.
Absolutely.
What about drug interactions between calcium and prescription medicines or things like that?
Well, it's fairly well known now that calcium does interfere with the absorption of certain drugs. One of them, a high blood pressure medication called atenolol or Tenorman. A lot of people
very
take
common,
that drug.
Very common blood pressure medicine.
Right. Tetracycline, salicylate products like aspirin type of products. Iron preparations.
We know in our work in dermatology, if we have someone taking tetracycline for acne, we'll tell them to avoid taking the tetracycline right with meals, because if they're taking it with the meal, it mixes with calcium and doesn't get absorbed into their body.
Well, it's the same thing with these other drugs. If you just separate the administration of those drugs, there isn't a problem. The absorption of calcium can also be altered by certain drugs, and I think what you need to do is just speak with your pharmacist to find out.
What would you say to me? I come into your pharmacist as a typical patient, and I say, I hear that it might be good to take some calcium. What should I do? What would you tell me?
Well, I would want to know your age, so I could determine roughly where, you know, how much elemental calcium you should be taking a day, and that would sort of fall in the range of 1,000 to 1,500 milligrams a day. We would talk about the medications that you're currently taking. We would then determine which product to sell you. We would tell you the difference between the labeling and the elemental calcium content of the tablets. We would encourage you to take it with your meals, not on an empty stomach, not late at night. I think those are the types of things that we would want to know and discuss with you, so we were pretty sure that you were going to be taking it properly.
Bob, as usual, very, very good information, and I hope that our viewers will discuss their concerns regarding vitamins and mineral supplements with their pharmacists and doctors very soon. We look forward to you returning to the Pharmacy Corner, Bob, on future programs. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Always a pleasure.
Thanks.
Now on with the Medical Explorer. Have you ever thought about being in the nightmarish situation of having your doctor tell you that there is an abnormal spot on your chest x-ray and that they need to go in and into your chest and get a piece of tissue to see whether it might be cancer? Well, this scenario happens almost every day in the medical community. In the past, patients would have to go through a major surgery to find the answer. Tonight, with the gracious invitation of Dr. Alan Coulson and the well-respected St. Joseph Medical Center in Stockton, we will actually get a chance to see a procedure that allows surgeons to look into the chest without major surgery and perform a variety of procedures. Before beginning the procedure demonstration tonight, I'd like to reintroduce you to heart surgeon, chest surgeon, Dr. Alan Coulson. Dr. Coulson, welcome back to the Medical Explorer.
Thank you very much. Thank
it's
you.
A true pleasure to have you come to Yuba City today and be in our studios and show us some things that you're going to talk about. The concept of looking in the chest without having to do the two-foot incision of that type of surgery is just fantastic. What is the procedure called? What are we going to be looking at today?
It's called thoracoscopy, which means looking inside the chest with a television camera.
And what can you do with this?
At the present time, we can do biopsies of the lung and biopsies of the pleura, which is the lining inside the lung, or any nodules that we can see. We're hoping in the future to be able to take out pieces of the lung, like a whole lobe or even the whole lung. That's the eventual aim. But right now we're at the biopsy stage and also at the stage of examining the lung to look for any bad areas.
Can you describe what the procedure would be like? Let's say a patient, like we described earlier, goes to their family doctor who does his annual chest x-ray and sees a big spot there. And the doctor says something has to be done to find this out, so they call you on the phone, Dr. Coulson, I'm setting up an appointment for my patient.
Exactly.
What then do you go through?
Well, I explain to them the best approach in many cases would be to remove that nodule. So, and if it's benign, that solves the whole problem. If it's malignant, you need to take a bigger piece of lung around it. And up until a year ago, we'd be looking at a thoracotomy, where you have to cut the chest open, like you said, with a big incision. But now we have this new technique, thoracoscopy, available. We can actually look inside there and biopsy without making a big operation out of it. And they can be home in 2 or 3 days.
That's fantastic. So a patient can actually have a piece of their lung removed, or pleura, the lining around the lung, and go back to work within a week or so.
Yes, it doesn't hurt.
It's just incredible. I just know people have been off sometimes for months after those types of procedures.
Exactly, yeah. It's a big step forward.
Another interesting thing I was thinking about earlier was we often have patients in their 60s, 70s, 80s who find findings like this, and some of those patients have other medical problems that, you know, that type of long, drawn-out surgery isn't safe.
Exactly, yeah. And for these people, this is perfect because it doesn't put the strain on their heart and on their respiratory reserves. It doesn't use up those reserves, so they can tolerate this thoracoscopy, whereas they could not tolerate thoracotomy. Exactly.
If the procedure goes very smoothly and you want to take a little sample and do this in the hospital, how long is a person usually under anesthesia asleep?
Between 30 and 60 minutes.
That's an incredible improvement. Yeah. What would an average thoracotomy?
Thoracotomy, you're looking at 1.5 hours to 3 hours or awesome. 4 hours, depending on how much you have to do. Yeah.
And so putting someone under total anesthesia, making them asleep that long, has a lot more risks.
Oh, exactly, exactly, yeah.
So, boy, the anesthesiologists must be pleased to be able to work with some of these older people that they couldn't even do before. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
What's the role of actually using television with this procedure?
The television camera is actually put inside the chest, so we don't see with our own eyes what we're doing. We're looking on a television screen, so it's video surgery. Well, the scene that we see on the television camera, which you will in fact be seeing yourself in a few minutes, is what we see. We don't actually get the hand-eye coordination that we would normally have in the surgery. We have to learn to work through a television camera.
So what's happening is you're dealing with the little tools through the chest, which we'll look at, and in another little hole through the chest wall, you have a camera looking at what you're doing.
Precisely, yeah.
And so you're actually looking up at a TV monitor as you're doing these, and you're not actually looking at your hands directly in front of your face.
Exactly. We have to learn a whole new methodology, yeah.
Yeah, and so you have to be able to judge your movements through the television.
Exactly. You got it right.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
We hear a lot about different procedures being done with this type of television viewing. One procedure that's come into the media a lot is being able to remove a gallbladder without having to do the whole large procedure. Is this similar in any way?
Very similar methodology, yes, exactly. In fact, this is in many ways an offspring or derivative from that technology.
How is a laser used? What do you do there?
The laser beam is used to stop the bleeding, to coagulate, and also it can be used to cut, and it gives a nice smooth cut, and but the coagulation stops the blood from oozing from the area we've been operating. So we can use a flexible cord and bring the laser beam and aim it to an exact spot in there.
And that's where fiber optics also comes in, with the laser going through the glass fibers.
The new technology is wonderful, yeah.
I think a lot of this technology must stem back to the space program back in the 60s and 70s that developed now into civilian uses. It's just fantastic. We're always concerned in modern medicine, especially now with all of the talk about healthcare costs, to try to find ways of dealing with things in a little less expensive way.
Yeah.
On our program, we don't usually get into exact costs of things, but does it save money to do this type of procedure rather than the other?
Very much so. I mean, I think one day in the intensive care unit, you're looking at $1,000 to $2,000. So if you can keep that patient out of the intensive care unit or of a very short stay there, you're going to save thousands of dollars right there. And if you cut the hospitalization down to a third of the normal time, you're saving time, money right there.
Dr. Coulson, I know that our viewers are really looking forward to seeing the actual procedure, but before we go down to Stockton, I'd like you to show us some of the equipment. I think it'll be more meaningful for when we actually look at the scenes in the operating room.
This is a trocar that we put through the chest wall. And the way this works is that this safety sheath comes off as it goes through the chest wall. So if you can imagine, this is the chest wall. We push this through, and the blade goes through, cutting its way in, and then we can take the central part out and put a television camera through that.
So that provides you with a tube, an open tube like a pipe, that lets you put your equipment through.
Exactly. Then we can put this, for example, through there. And if that was a piece of lung to biopsy, I can get a hold of that. And if you take the other stapling device, you could staple that corner, for example. If I held it, you could staple off that corner.
So I would then clamp it on.
Yes, you'd have to move yours around.
The lock has to come off.
Until you had the corner lined up. Then squeeze the top one first.
That clamps down.
And then take off the safety device.
Got it.
And then just fire the trigger.
That pushes down. Oops. And then that will open up.
And then I hold this piece, and then, when you open up, that should have stapled it.
And that's interesting.
There's a good line of staples there, which makes it airtight. If that was lung tissue, that would be airtight and also blood tight.
So we could actually then, now is there a line between, so you've got it on both sides?
Yes, and then we would need another stapler on this side, and that would take that biopsy off, and we could take that out of the chest. And have a specimen for the pathologist.
So not only does this device put the staple in, it also provides your cut.
Cuts as well, yeah.
That's just fantastic. It saves about four or five movements there. That's
wonderful. It's really wonderful, yeah.
And then left in the chest would be the edge of the lung tissue closed already.
With staples.
It's actually got three rows of staples there to keep it from bleeding.
So there's no bleeding and no air leak.
That's just fantastic.
That's good.
So we've seen, let me just review. You have the trocar device that punctures through.
It punctures through to get, and that's the objective here, is to introduce this pipe.
The pipe,
and you leave the pipe behind as your access, and through this, your instruments are introduced into the chest.
Right. Now, would this fit through there as well?
There's a size bigger. This is a 10 millimeter. There's one size bigger that accommodates that.
I see.
And there'll be a camera in there watching these two pieces of equipment, as you'll see on the video.
The camera would go through with the same type
of device. It goes through a size 12, yeah, slightly bigger size than that, yeah.
Right, so all the person really has then is two openings in the skin big enough just to fit these two pipes in.
Exactly.
And when you're done, we'll see, you'll just close it up and two little areas with some stitches in and
exactly, yeah.
Back to work in a few days.
Yeah.
That's just such modern, tremendous new things.
This is
great.
It's fantastic.
Well, you've got my curiosity really high, and I know our viewers are ready to head down to Stockton. So let's head down Interstate 5 and go to St. Joseph Medical Center in Stockton in the operating room and actually take a look at thoracoscopy. You have that x-ray from the general practitioner's office that shows an abnormality before you do the procedure. What are we looking at on the x-ray?
On the right-hand side of the screen is the heart border, left-hand side is the right side chest wall, and picked out with the little black marks, there's a nodule in that right upper lobe of the lung.
Mm-hmm. And that nodule is some type of abnormality. What could that be? What are the possibilities?
It could be a lung cancer, or it could be tuberculosis or valley fever, or it could be a benign nodule, most likely a malignancy.
Okay. So now we're going to go into the operating room where you're set up to do the procedure. What do we see here?
What we're doing here is we have a catheter, a trocar, introduced into the chest wall, and we're having a preliminary look inside the chest cavity. The patient's lying on his left side, and we are putting now a trocar through the chest wall, and the patient's asleep and can't feel this. And this is secured in position.
So this is putting that little pipe into the tissue
into
to
chest
be
wall.
Able to look inside.
And this is the view on the television camera from inside.
Why don't we freeze right there, and we can see that the little opening, the whole opening there is very small.
Yes,
And the so that little pipe device will go through. We can continue looking through as that goes in.
Mm-hmm. And that's our
there it is.
There's our port. You're inside the chest now, looking with the television camera at the inside of the chest wall, and that's the.
Let me be sure our viewers have the orientation right too. So a few inches away from this, in the same chest area, is another opening exactly or very similar to this, with a very tiny TV camera.
Exactly.
Probably as small as your thumb.
Mm-hmm.
And that camera then is aimed in the direction of where this is going through the chest.
So we can see it, yes. Yeah.
All right, let's see what happens next.
And here, in fact, is a picture of us putting the television camera through the port, so you can see the size of the camera. It has its own light source on the end, so there's a bright light, which is, and that's it being washed. And then here's the camera being introduced into the port.
In that little
and there's
pipe.
A view now going down the pipe.
Oh, that's fascinating.
So that's the view you would get at the end of the camera.
Why don't we stop there for a second and see what we're looking at. What's on the right there and the left? What are we looking at?
On the right-hand side of the screen is the middle the mediastinum with the heart. On the left-hand side are the inside of the ribs.
Ah.
And between the ribs is a catheter, metal pipe.
So on top of the picture, if you went up and kept going through, you'd end up outside the body.
Yes.
You're looking right at the inside of the wall of the chest.
Exactly, yes.
And then coming through from the outside, like a little device digging down,
mm-hmm.
is that pipe that
right.
you're going to introduce your instruments through.
Exactly, yeah.
Great,
yeah.
Let's see what's next then.
I mean, this is a surveillance now, looking around to see if we can see the disease spot we can see on the chest x-ray and orienting the camera. And the next scene we go into is a biopsy, where we remove an area that was suspicious for tumor on the wall of the chest. But here's a nice view of the second and third and fourth ribs.
Oh, that's fantastic.
With the muscles in between them, intercostal muscles, and the shiny pleura, which is the delicate lining. Now here's a grasping forceps going forward to do a biopsy. That yellow material we thought was infiltrated with cancer. And we had to rule that out prior to resecting lung tissue.
Why don't we stop there, and you can see that little device which is going to grasp a piece of tissue.
Mm-hmm.
And is that what you're biopsying, the piece you're grasping?
That's the piece we're grasping. That yellow area was on the CT scan was thought to be infiltrated with cancer, yeah.
I see. Just want to make it clear now, if this was in the middle of the lung, inside, you wouldn't be doing the same procedure.
Right? Exactly, yeah.
So we're more on the outside of the lung or on the chest wall.
On chest wall, yeah.
Okay. Moving on. You're lifting the area, grasping it.
Am I going to remove that piece by tearing it, tearing a piece of that off, just rolling it from side to side, taking a piece off?
You know from your experience that it's safe to do that with this type
yes,
of tissue.
Yes, yeah, that piece was safe, yeah. And then we go back and take a bigger piece.
This is an actual device that grips and cuts at the same time?
This has grasping teeth, and this is more of a just tearing a piece of it off. Then we go back and stop the bleeding with a laser, which is the next scene here.
Why don't we stop there for a second, and you can actually see that little point of light
mm-hmm.
that's at the end of some fiber optic tubes.
Yes.
And so the light's going through there, and it's almost like watching a Star Trek episode here where you have the laser beam coagulating, stopping the bleeding.
Stopping the bleeding at that biopsy site, yeah. We can stop the bleeding by just touching with a laser beam. And it's very, very accurate.
Okay.
move on.
And that's the smoke from the laser.
Do you have a vacuum device in there to suck it out?
We put one in later on. That smoke is a bit of a nuisance, but we can suck it out. If you suck too hard, the lung inflates.
I see.
In other words, if you create a vacuum, the lung comes back up. So
right.
We kind of have to live with the smoke a little bit.
You actually collapse that one lung during the procedure.
Exactly.
So
that lung
has space to work.
Exactly. That lung is down. So it's out of the way, yes.
And so you're using the laser beam and moving around to be sure that when you
there's
finish,
no bleeding.
There's no bleeding going on.
Exactly. You don't want any bleeding there. Yeah. Now, this is a different type of biopsy. This is using the big stapler that we used just now on the piece of paper. And this is a view inside the chest, so that stapling device to biopsy a wedge of lung tissue.
So there you're gripping over, and you've got, there's that rim of staples that stays
that's the first
in
row in. Then we come from the other side now and staple the other way, just to make sure that we've got it totally sealed off before we take it out. So there's another stapler coming in now to staple at an angle so we get a wedge biopsy of lung tissue.
Now these instruments look very big, but as they saw earlier, these are very small instruments.
Small, yeah. The TV camera amplifies the picture, so you get a really close-up view here.
You have to remember that those instruments are no bigger than half of a finger. They're
mm-hmm.
very small in
exactly,
size.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah.
So you've gripped that tissue.
I'm cutting it.
Is that lung tissue?
That's a piece of lung. That's the right upper lobe. Yeah.
I see.
And this is the area of suspicion of containing cancer inside that wedge we've taken out. And there's this staple line again.
Mm-hmm. It doesn't hurt the body to leave some of those staples inside.
No, it doesn't. And then it's safe to go through airport security screens. It's titanium, and it's safe to have MRI scans and so on.
Great. That's just fascinating. Thank you very much for letting us go in the operating room with you. That is just great.
It is interesting.
Let's talk about what's the future for this technique. Can you foresee bigger procedures, more things happening?
I think very much so. That's where we're headed, to try and take out a whole lobe of lung, and even the whole lung itself. If we can get better instrumentation, then we can do almost all conventional lung surgery could be done through these small openings.
That's just fantastic.
Yeah.
So if you found out a part of the lung had a tumor and someday you could remove that whole part.
Whole lobe, yeah.
Now there's certain cases you'll look inside and find that you can't do that type of surgery. What would be going on in that case?
If we found, for example, on looking with the camera that the cancer had invaded too far into the chest wall or into the area around the heart where it's inoperable, then we've saved the patient from a big operation, because by looking with a television camera, maybe taking a few of those little tearing biopsies, and we demonstrate cancer there, then we can say, well, we have to stop. We cannot do surgical resection. This is a radiation case or chemotherapy
right.
case. And the patient's spared a very painful and large incision.
Right. They've got an answer, and they didn't have to go through that major surgery.
Exactly, yeah.
Well, I want to thank you, Dr. Coulson, for coming out to our Medical Explorer studios and for letting the cameras go inside the operating room. It's just fantastic. We actually got to see actual thoracoscopy procedure. If you have questions about this procedure, you should bring them to the attention of your personal physician. The Medical Explorer looks forward to returning to Stockton and St. Joseph Medical Center with Dr. Coulson as he continues our exploration of his fascinating field of heart and thoracic surgery. Dr. Coulson, as a specialist in heart and thoracic surgery, there are many areas that you can show us on this program, and I really want to get together with you again so we can take a look at more things.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Just fantastic again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, that's our program for tonight. I'd like to invite you to write to me at the Dermatology and Allergy Office in Yuba City with your suggestions for areas and people that you'd like to see on this program. I'm always interested in hearing from you, and I hope that you'll suggest to your medical doctor or other healthcare professional that you'd like to see them here with me on the Medical Explorer. As you know, we are a public service program, and I really do want to hear from you with your comments and suggestions. Please write to me at the Skin and Allergy Medical Group of Yuba City, 350 Del Norte Avenue, Yuba City, California, 95991. In my next program, The Medical Explorer will take you behind the scenes of more interesting frontiers of medical care practices in the Yuba City, Marysville, and Stockton areas. Till next time, I'm Dr. Robert Peppercorn, your Medical Explorer. Thank you for joining us tonight, and have a good evening.